Hello, my name is Mario. Welcome to the first video of Software Architecture in Go, where I cover everything related to software architecture using Go as the main programming language. This time, because it's the first episode, I'm going to be introducing to you something that all the engineers, software developers, and even software architects are always looking forward to doing. That is creating documentation. I know it's kind of a joke, but it's important that if you're aspiring to become a software architect, you need to consider creating documentation as part of your daily life, as part of your daily responsibilities. And I'm not trying to give you bad news, but it's something that you need to consider when creating an architecture, when sharing that documentation and those details with your team, with the stakeholders, and obviously with the future you, because you are the one that is going to be perhaps taking care and maintaining this system of this service for the long run. So this is the C4 model. It's something that I found really useful. I've been using it for years already, and I think it's one of the most nice ways to create documentation diagrams, specifically for sharing with different stakeholders, depending on how they are supposed to be seeing the system in a different way. So let's jump into the code. Let's jump into what is C4 model, and I will give you three different ways to create diagrams using the C4 model. So what is the C4 model? The C4 model is an abstraction first approach for diagramming software architecture. It was created by Simon Brown. And the idea behind this is that we create maps of our code at various levels of detail. And let's think of this: if we were planning to create a system for the Statue of Liberty, the way we're going to be creating those diagrams is dependent on how much visibility we want to give to the system and who is our audience. So for example, in the beginning, perhaps for the initial stakeholders, maybe the non-technical people, they don't really care exactly how this is implemented. They just care about what is the principal view, sort of like the zoom out view of the system that we currently have. This is what we're calling the level one system context. If we want to zoom in a little bit more, perhaps for more technical people, maybe the tech leads, or maybe more involve different stakeholders, third parties, maybe they need to know a little bit more of the details that we need to show or we need to implement. This is covered in the container diagram. When we zoom in even more, there is another view that indicates even more details that in the end are useful for, again, for a different audience. We're trying to describe the actual content of what we described before as a container. This is called the component diagram. And finally, the fourth level in the basic diagrams in the C4 model is what we're calling the code diagram. And this will be what you were expecting, literally the actual code, maybe some sequence diagrams, or things that indicate concrete algorithms and whatnot about the actual system that we're implementing. It's sort of the way you see it is there is a system context, container, component, and code. That's why it's called the C4, because there are four C's. So let me show you three different ways that I like doing it, and depending it's up to you how you handle it. I have my own opinion and my own preference, but I want to give you these three different ways to do it that works also for Go and also for a different programming languages. So let's look at the code and let's see how this looks in real life. As usual, the links to the repositories and all the different projects that I'm going to be using are going to be listed in the description of this video. So please feel free to check those out, clone them, play with them, and have fun with them. The first one that I'm going to be using is I'm going to be referring to the Tuto microservice API that we have been using for our previous series for building microservices in Go. And this one I'm going to be diagramming what I currently have, and I'm going to be basically implementing this user interface that I have, not this user interface, this diagram that I have here. So it's pretty simple. And if you remember, again, going from the four different layers, we have system context, component, and container and component, and also code. I don't like diagramming code diagrams because, again, it depends on the actual algorithm or maybe the sequence that we're trying to implement or we're trying to describe, because in the end, the code is often changing. What doesn't change that often are the layers that are above them, which in this case of Go will be packages and different compiled binaries and those kind of things, okay? So I'm using this package called Goa Designed/Model that allows you to use a DSL for creating C4 models. And there are a few examples right here. And the way it works, again, is in the repository that I'm going to be linking in the description, is it defines a DSL that it works by grouping the different diagrams or different views nested into each other. So if we have, if you look at the person, which right here, which is basically the user of our system, and then the system, which defines the big container of everything else, and inside the systems, there are containers, which in this case represent artifacts that are deployed independently of each other, which will be usually databases, data stores, memory structures, or something that is a container independent of each other. A binary, in our example, it will be the RESTful API, the Elasticsearch indexer, those kind of things. And inside, depending on the container, inside of each container, you may have components. And those components, in the case of Go, will be packages or different ways to communicate using RPC. Perhaps it's not a it's not using a package directly, maybe it's doing some sort of different communication using RPCs, or maybe the way it's implementing the actual container inside, the actual component inside the container. Our example is using components and packages, just to give you an idea, but you can think of maybe if you're using DLLs in C Sharp, or maybe jars in Java, it's basically sort of the same idea. So with that in view, everything you define in the code, you can then define concrete views, which are the diagrams. If you look at this, I have defined the system diagram, container diagram, a component diagram, and another component diagram right here. If I run the instruction that I have here for running the sort of like a user interface for rendering the diagrams that we created using the Go DSL, we can look at that right here. And in the beginning, the first version that we have is going to be all messed up. It's not going to be arranged. This one, I already, you know, I click auto layout, so it fixes the layout on the screen. But if I go to containers the first time, you will see that it's all messed up. But if you feed it, you will be more or less, it will look more or less better. The cool thing about this is that you can actually rearrange all of these things and organize them the way you want it. And similarly, if we go to the container, we feed it, it will look like that, and the same idea will be with the other component view that we have for the RESTful API. The cool thing about this is that the Goa package allows you to build a JSON that works with a service called Structurizr. And the Structurizr is a service that Simon Brown created for organizing and creating diagrams using the C4 model. So you can create your code using Go and then export that code into a JSON that then you can use into this service that is not free, you need to pay for it, but it's really useful. I already exported that JSON, and the instruction for generating that JSON is right here. You use stz gen and the package that you want to generate, it will generate JSON. Then you can either upload manually to the service using, you know, your typical upload file kind of a process, or you can actually connect the different token and literally push the value directly to the service itself. So I have it right here. If you notice, it's sort of more or less similar. Obviously, it's not the same because this is the open source version and this is more or less the paid version. But the way I like it, and again, going back to the example with the maps, is that when you click or you zoom in into one of these different boxes, you can get more detail about it. And this is the special thing about this C4 model of creating diagrams. So in this case, I have this software system. If I double click it, it will go and jump into the definition of what is contained by the software system, which in this case, it will be a bunch of different containers. If you notice, I have the RESTful API here, the CLI tool, I have my different databases or data stores, which are also containers, and I have another container for receiving events and indexing values in Elasticsearch. If I click one of these that happens to have anything defined for them, I will go and also jump in and zoom in into the data, into their values, into their information, and see more details about it. So if I click RESTful, I will say, hey, the RESTful API container is built using the internal REST package. There is an internal PostgreSQL package, an internal service package, and so on and so forth, and how it communicates outside of the boundaries, which is, again, is a container. It's supposed to be sort of like a binary, an artifact that is distributed in your architecture. And if I go back to the other one and I click, this is the CLI, for example, it will be doing something similar. It defines a Kafka that is pulling the events from an internal Kafka package that is pulling the events from Kafka. There is an internal Elasticsearch package that is receiving the events from Elasticsearch and updating an iterate index and the values and whatnot. So this is a cool thing, and you see how everything sort of gives you different point of views depending on how you see it. So you have, you know, the system context diagram, you have the container, and then the components. And again, as usual, I don't create code diagrams because the code usually changes that often, and most of the times creating code diagrams is not needed. So let's jump into another example that is not using Go, is not using a Structurizr, is using another really popular tool called PlantUML. Let's look at the example. For this last example, I blog about it. I created a post, and I will add, again, as usual, I will leave that link in the description as well. It describes a different way to create the C4 diagrams, but using a tool called PlantUML. That is most likely you have used that in the past before for creating diagrams using the graphs, this way to describe diagrams using a text. And that using a plugin called the PlantUML C4 model allows you to actually create C4 models that happen to be used the shapes that are defined or were described by Simon Brown. For this, I have the code on GitLab. It's basically the same, but I'm using a different service, a different system rather, that I used in the past with my previous videos that it consisted of the book system. But it's basically the same idea. One of the things that I do like about this one is that it includes a legend. Like this one includes, hey, the person is this color blue, there is a system, there is some external person, external systems and whatnot. But the thing I don't like is that obviously it doesn't integrate directly with the Structurizr, which is the service that is most likely going to be useful if it makes sense for you. For distributing these diagrams with your team. However, there is another thing that I do like. If you happen to use the Visual Studio, there is an integration that allows you to also define your snippets or your code using Visual Studio, and you can actually create, like you can see in on the screen, you can actually define and it will create your diagrams behind the scenes. So that's another cool thing to do. And the cool thing about this is that you don't have to use Go, for example. It's literally just Java, and you create the PlantUML files that are basically just using the PlantUML code or the PlantUML instructions. And then from there, you can define much more user-friendly or much more detailed diagrams. Like for example, this one, it has some Go icons that represent the Go package, and this one has the elephant for the PostgreSQL database, and those kind of things that, you know, it could be nice to have. It's not as user friendly as, for example, the one using Goa. There is no UI to my knowledge yet, so everything that you see right here, you have to organize it manually. So that's why you may see some of the PlantUML files that happen to have a bunch of rel instructions that indicate how these boxes are going to be organized relative to another box. So it can get complicated if you add a bunch of different things, but in the end it's just, you know, sometimes that you need to invest for creating a good diagram. And with that, let's jump into the code, into the final conclusions, and let's see what we can do, what we think about creating diagrams using the C4 model. So this is the C4 model. It allows you to define different diagrams for your software architecture, for your system, with different views and different details that you can present and share with different stakeholders, depending on how much information they need to have. I show you three different ways to do it. There are obviously different ways if you use Java or C#, but the process is sort of more or less similar. With this series that I'm starting right now, I want to give you a different point of view of when you're working with software architecture, specifically in Go, but also in other different languages, because in the end, the architecture doesn't have to be based 100% using one specific programming language. It can be literally a bunch of different technologies and a combination of different things and tools. But what is important here is not only talking about the options that we have when using Go for creating diagrams using code, but also at the same time having the idea that creating diagrams, creating documentation is something that we always need to consider. It may not be as flashy or it may not be as interesting, quote unquote, as some other things when you're building software, but it's something like, if you are aspiring to become a software architecture, you need to think that, hey, documentation is important, we need to have it up to date, and we need to find those tools that in the end are easy to update, are useful are not that difficult to maintain, and in the end give enough value for the team members and for all your audience that is going to be using those artifacts, which in the end are diagrams. So hopefully all of this makes sense, and thank you for watching, and I will talk to you next time. Again, the links are in the description of this video. The repositories are again in the description of this video. Any questions, any comments, please let me know. Take care. I will talk to you next time. See you.